Hi, I'm Elaine Mills with Master Gardeners of Northern Virginia, here today to talk about an invasive plant, Japanese knotweed, Fallopia japonica. This particular plant can be recognized by its hollow jointed stems, and leaves that are arranged alternately in kind of a zigzag pattern. The leaves themselves are fairly large. They are somewhat triangular in shape with a distinctly pointed tip and a very flat base. You'll see sprays of creamy white flowers late in the summer, around July to August. As a reminder, invasiveness has an official definition, and this was outlined in two executive orders signed by Presidents Clinton and Obama. Together, those two directives state that an invasive species is one that is not native to the area in which it is found. It can escape cultivation and spread into the wild, and when it does so, it causes harm, either economically, environmentally, or harm to humans, animals, or plants. Japanese knotweed meets all of these characteristics. It is not native to the United States. It was brought here from Japan in the 1800s for its ornamental qualities and for erosion control. It began escaping cultivation in the 1930s, and it's now designated as invasive throughout a good portion of the United States, except for the far south, the arid southwest, and the high Rocky Mountains. It's considered to be especially problematic in riparian areas. Japanese knotweed grows quite aggressively, as much as 3 inches in a day, and will ultimately reach a height of about 10 feet, creating a very dense bamboo-like thicket. This will suppress the growth of native plants. Abundant winged seeds can be dispersed by wind and water, and the plant can also spread vegetatively through its extensive root system, reaching as much as 30 feet beyond the parent plant. In addition, Japanese knotweed has allelopathic qualities. It can send the chemicals into the soil, changing the soil chemistry and inhibiting the growth of other plants. When it does that, creating a monoculture, the native plants that are needed to support our wildlife will not be able to grow successfully. Stands of Japanese knotweed also cause problems with infrastructure. The roots can grow through asphalt paving, through concrete paths as much as 3 inches deep. It can grow through patios and even into the foundations of buildings. Japanese knotweed is quite a challenge to control. If you have small young plants, you might be able to successfully dig them out. You would want to do this very carefully and thoroughly because even small stem and root fragments can regrow, and you would certainly dispose of all this material in the trash. It's best if you have a stand of knotweed to control it by using a systemic herbicide. This would be done by either spraying the foliage or injecting the liquid into the stems. This treatment is most effective when it is timed after flowering. This would be in late summer or early fall. The reason for this is the plant is beginning to draw down resources to store in the rhizomes over the winter. And as it draws down nutrients and sugars, it will also draw down the systemic herbicide. If you have a more substantial invasion of this plant, you would definitely want to call in for professional help. And I strongly recommend that you check out the fact sheet created by Michigan State University. This describes multiple control programs, giving you several selections of herbicides you might consider and explaining safety precautions. Once you've removed invasive Japanese knotweed, we're lucky in that we have a number of native plants that make excellent alternatives. We're here in a natural area in Arlington County, Virginia, not too far from where we filmed the Japanese knotweed last summer. The obvious choice of a replacement plant for that invasive species is the native Virginia knotweed, Persicaria virginiana. This is also known as jump seed because the mature seeds, when they have pressure from your hand, will release very quickly from the plant for easy dispersal. As you can see, the native species also has jointed stems. The leaves are somewhat similar in shape. They do have the point, but they're much more elongated, an elongated oval, and they're definitely rounded rather than squared off at the top. As you can see, the native species thrives in part to full shade. It will grow about 1 to 4 feet tall. It likes moist soil.
Virginia knotweed has tiny white flowers that are widely spaced in long curving racemes in summer. These are very attractive to butterflies. The plant tolerates drought once established and is also resistant to deer. It can spread rapidly both by rhizomes and self-seeding, making it an excellent choice for massing as a ground cover in your woodland garden.
The second native plant I'd like to recommend is goat's beard, Aruncus dioicus. This is a shrub-like herbaceous perennial. It can grow about 1 to 4 feet tall, and it's particularly noted for its feathery flowers. These will be blooming from April to May, attracting bees, butterflies, and other pollinators. The plant has a native range from Maine all the way to Georgia. And it will do best in part shade, as you see here in the southern part of its range, I'd say from Virginia south. It definitely prefers moist soil. The foliage will begin to decline if the soil is allowed to dry out. Goat's beard is a dioecious species. That means that there are separate male and female flowers on different plants. The male flowers are said to be showier, but the female plant will have the advantage of ornamental seed heads later in the season. Goat's beard has compound foliage, you can see here, and this serves as a source of food for caterpillars of our native butterflies, and it will turn a brilliant shade of yellow in the fall. The third native replacement plant I'd like to recommend is another tall perennial. This is woodland sunflower. It belongs to the Keystone Helianthus genus. This is Helianthus divaricatus. It will grow about 2 to 6 feet tall and provide wonderful support for our wildlife. It serves as a larval host plant for numerous butterflies and moths. And its large yellow flowers, which bloom from July to September, will provide nectar and pollen for many of our pollinators.
This cheerful plant thrives in part shade and dry to moist soil. It will spread slowly over time to create large colonies.
Whichever native plant you choose as a replacement for invasive Japanese knotweed, I wish you happy gardening.